It says, come near to God, and he will come near to you.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Protection. Now it comes in ways that we would never have imagined. It comes with passwords, it comes with eye and finger technology, when it comes to our smartphones. It comes in a million different ways because we need to keep ourselves safe. But where does ultimate safety come from? That's what we want to explore this morning as we hear God's word, the safety that is ours in Christ Jesus. Today's order of worship is on the screen, and we begin with our opening song, We Declare Your Majesty.
Therefore, as a called and ordained servant of Christ,
And by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are forgiven in Christ. We have been cleansed of our sins. Amen.
So righteous as all this law that I set before you today.
Only take care and keep your soul diligently, lest you forget the things that your eyes have seen, and lest they depart from your heart all the days of your life. Make them known to your children and your children's children. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today, portion is Psalm 119. Turn to me and be gracious to me.
As is your way with those who love your name.
Your testimonies are wonderful, therefore my soul keeps them.
The unfolding of your words gives light, it imparts understanding to the soul.
I open my mouth and pant, because I long for your commandments.
Turn to me and be gracious to me, as is your way with those who love your name.
Keep steady my steps according to your promise, and let no iniquity get dominion over me.
Redeem me from man's oppression, that I may keep your precepts.
Make your face shine upon your servant, and teach me your statutes.
My eyes shall stream with tears, because people do not keep your law.
Turn to me and be gracious to me, as is your way, with those who love your name. Today's epistle is from Ephesians chapter 6, where wisdom and understanding comes by understanding that our wisdom and strength comes from God himself. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints, and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia. Blessed are the pure in spirit, for they shall see God. Hallelujah. We rise for the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 7th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Wisdom and understanding comes by hearing and taking to heart what Jesus says in his word. Jesus reminds us that if we merely listen to our own hearts, we see nothing but darkness. But listening to his words, we have light, we have life, and we have salvation. Jesus called the people to him again and said to them, "Hear me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going into him can defile him, but the things that come out of a person are what defile him." And when he had entered the house and left the people, his disciples asked him about the parable. And he said to them, "Then are you also without understanding? Do you not see whatever goes into a person from outside cannot defile him, since it enters not his heart but his stomach and is expelled?" Thus he declared all foods clean. And he said, "What comes out of a person is what defiles him. From within, out of the heart of man, comes evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise,
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
We continue with our sermon song, Living Stones. Please be seated. The armor of God. The Apostle Paul urges us to put that on, because that's our wisdom and our strength. That's our peace. That's our protection in a dark and growing darker world. Until the last day comes, the Apostle Paul urges us that Christians are locked into combat because the enemy is relentless. He's formidable. What is at stake is nothing less than your soul and mine and the souls of countless millions. Where they will spend, where we will spend eternity. Now this morning, I don't want anyone to leave this morning that somehow the Apostle Paul is over-exaggerating here or raising all sorts of false alarms to get people scared. Don't underestimate or downplay what the Apostle is saying in today's text. Christ has won the victory. That's true and certain. That remains for time and for all eternity. The devil is vanquished. But that doesn't mean that he's sued for terms of peace. That doesn't mean that he's rolled over and played dead. That does not mean that he's going to give up and call it quits. That won't happen until judgment day. But in the meantime, the Apostle Paul, as we hear today's epistle, says, be ready. Spiritual warfare is defined. First of all, identify your enemy, and secondly, use the weapons that Christ himself provides. The Apostle Paul says, finally be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. I don't know what words could be more clear than what the enemy is. Because this is an enemy that we can't see. But it is an enemy who is real, who is not a figment of someone's medieval imagination, but an enemy that works in the minds, the hearts, the words, and the actions, and the attitudes of people the world over. And that also includes you and me. Because we have a sinful nature, and we live in a sinful world. And Satan knows that those are his two best allies when it comes to gaining more for his kingdom. Yes, it's easy. It's easy for us to see Satan's work all around us when it comes to our society, culture, and media. But what often goes unnoticed in today's world is what goes on in the churches. And that's what the Apostle Paul is drawing our attention to. What's going on in the churches? There is a staff writer for the Horowitz Freedom Foundation by the name of Daniel Greenfield. And he wrote an article that talks about the quiet jihad that is going on in America's churches. Churches are closing. They're closing due to lack of attendance, lack of interest, lack of anything, because people have simply just given up on God. But these vacant structures don't remain vacant very long. There are other groups that snap them up, including Muslims who worship Allah. They use them for mosques, for madrasas, Islamic schools, and for Islamic community centers. Why? Because Americans just don't think that God works anymore. Maybe we've outgrown this whole idea of God to begin with. So there's no need to be seriously overly concerned about the faith. No need to share Christ, because after all, some think we still are a Christian country. And secondly, the vast majority believes that's your choice. That's a choice, a personal choice that you make. But you know what? Satan knows that if you're not listening to God or hearing or following the voice of Christ, sooner or later, you're going to be following him. And take all of this together with a healthy, healthy interest in our society when it comes to the occult, witchcraft, and demon worship for popular entertainment. evil goes unfettered and unhindered in the vast majority of lives. But you know, it's easy to talk about what's going on out there. We need to be concerned about what's going on in here. How do you see this business of good and evil? Is it a struggle? Is it something that's hard to do? Or is this just, again, some of these cosmic forces that you and I have no control over, and therefore we're kind of helpless and defenseless? Well, if you're going to listen to the world, that's how the world sees it. You can choose one or the other. But God tells us what the origin of evil is all about. The origin of evil takes us way back even before Adam and Eve and the fall into sin. The Apostle Paul and St. Peter talk about rebellion. A rebellion in heaven where Satan, one of God's powerfully created angels, led a revolt against the Lord God Almighty himself. He thought that he could overtake God. God threw him off, together with all of his angels that became demons. And as a result, they are condemned. Condemned to an existence where they will live apart and separated from God forever in hell and misery. And that's why Satan is so concerned. Satan wants more of God's creatures to enjoy this existence that he brought into himself. And that's where you and I come to the picture. Because Satan wasn't content to leave well enough alone. He came at the door of creation, and with Adam and Eve, the fall into sin occurred. And were it not for Christ, you and I would be doomed to this awful existence that Satan and his demons are experiencing right now. But my friends, the Lord God did something about that. He sent Christ, who became a human being, the perfect, eternal Son of God. This perfect and eternal Son of God took into himself what he had created in you and me. He became a human being. And he kept what the first Adam and the first woman were not able to do. And as a result of his perfect life, as a result of his perfect death, as a result of his resurrection, we are free. So what we need to understand is that Satan is not God's equal, nor will he ever be. But God, as a result of what Christ has done, has taken Satan and put him on a leash like a vicious dog. That chain will keep him under control to a certain extent, so that God can get the good news of salvation out. That's why he permits this sad, lonely, dark world to continue. Because God has the wonderful light of salvation, the light of salvation that he wants proclaimed from one generation to the next, so that they can see that there is a way out, that there is hope, and that there is life, and there will be peace. Not for a moment, not for a generation, but for all eternity itself. But the sad thing is, people like to play with fire, don't they? And as I said a few moments ago, Satan is God's willing allies of the world around us as well as our own sinful nature. And sometimes we get a little too close and we get bitten. And some who get bitten simply give up and give in. But that's why Christ is important. Christ has bound you and me with his word. God has made that word real in your life and mine through holy baptism. God says, through water and his word, you belong to me. You are a part of my family and a part of my kingdom forever. That's what is the wisdom and the strength of God. And that's why the Apostle Paul urges us to be on our guard when it comes to the devil's evil schemes. Schemes in the Greek language means craftiness and cunning. A craftiness and cunning that has no conscience whatsoever, because it will do whatever it is necessary to to achieve its own wicked purpose. That describes the devil's work perfectly. And one of his greatest schemes is doubt. Doubt worked in the Garden of Eden. Did God really say? And doubt still works today. Satan causes people to doubt the wisdom and the knowledge of God. When things don't go our way, we as Christians know that God urges us to pray, to bring all things before Him. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. We pray for people, for fellow Christians, family members, neighbors, people who are making wrong choices in their lives. We pray for ourselves when we have fear and anxiety. We pray and we pray and we pray, and then Satan begins to do his evil work. He begins to say to us, why don't you just give up? Why are you doing all that praying? What does it matter anyway? He's not listening. In these situations, the devil always sees opportunity. If he can wedge in our hearts doubt as far as God's wisdom is concerned, then he knows it's just a small step when it comes to denying the existence of God. By keeping our hearts focused on all of our heartaches, all of our worries, all of our anxieties, and all of our fears, God knows that we're not listening to him anymore, but we're simply listening to ourselves. Now that we know how the enemy works and who the enemy is, we need to also identify what the weapons are with this wisdom and understanding that God gives to us in his word. Paul in our epistle draws our attention to the average Roman soldier about 2,000 years ago. They stood anywhere between 5'9 and 5'11. They weren't big by our standards, but they were superbly conditioned. These were men who could march anywhere between 20 to 30 miles every single day, if needed, with full armor on. And they had the best armor that could be provided at that time. A double-edged sword, lances, great big shields, as well as the Roman strategy of the phalanx and the defensive turret. This made Rome the master of the world for over 1,000 years. Paul tells us we've been given weapons to fight with. He says, therefore take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. So what does God put at our disposal? Paul has the answer. Stand firm with the belt of truth. The question is, whose truth? Your truth? My truth? The world's truth? Or God's truth? I think as Christians, we're losing the fact that where truth comes from. Truth isn't something that's found in us, but it is something that is found in God's word. Doesn't Jesus make that point loud and clear in today's gospel? He tells us that out of our hearts comes murder, adultery, envy, jealousy, and all of those dark sins that he enumerates. But out of God's heart comes truth and love and forgiveness and righteousness. A belt is something that keeps everything together, doesn't it? Just as we count on our belt to keep us together from day to day when we're out and about, so also we want to have God's truth to keep us together during the days of evil, the days that we are experiencing now. And where is that truth? Jesus is the truth. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And that's why we need to keep on praying, sanctify us with your truth. Your word is truth. The only way we're going to get that truth is by hearing and listening and taking to heart God's word. That's what it comes down to. Not imagining all of our goodness and our intentions or all of the things we've done in the past, all the things we hope to do in the future, but listening to God's word and its truth right here and now. The next thing that God points to is the breastplate of righteousness. Now for a Roman soldier, this was a customized piece of weaponry. It with a sheet of metal that was formed around the chest, as well as wrist bar and arms around the wrist. And that's for the piece of armor that every Roman soldier treasured. In the same way, God has made a very custom piece of armament for you. That's your baptism. God came to you and me. And for many of us, when we weren't even looking for him, as mere babies, he came to us with water and the word and said, you belong to me in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. He placed his name upon us. We are members of his family. Yes, Jesus created a righteousness tailored for you specifically. Tailored through and through so that you can have peace from day to day that you belong to God. And that's why each and every day we need to get up with the understanding that we are baptized children of God. I'm a baptized children of God. You are the baptized children of God. It's that wonderful truth that keeps us safe so that we don't have to get caught up in all of the worry and anxiety of the moment. But Paul goes on. He says, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. These weapons that Paul enumerates here now are offensive weapons. Weapons by which you and I can keep moving ahead. That's what he means with the sword of the Spirit. In the book of Hebrews, the writer there reminds us that the Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. It cuts through joints and marrow, revealing the heart, revealing the truth of how God really feels about you and me through Christ our Savior. And look at Jesus. Jesus certainly wielded that sword of the Spirit. Jesus used that sword as a shield. Jesus had to learn the Word of God just as you and I do, as a 12-year-old boy in the temple. And Jesus didn't think of it as just in one ear and out the other. I've heard that story before. Jesus heard what God had revealed to his people in the Old Testament again and again. Because if you read the Gospels through carefully, Jesus and his disciples went to the synagogue regularly and faithfully. It wasn't in one ear and out the other. And why? Because Jesus knew. Jesus knew that the days of evil would come for him. It came for him in those 40 days and 40 nights in the wilderness when he was all alone, struggling with temptation. And what did Jesus do when the devil came to him? Jesus again said, again and again, it is written. And my friends, that's a wonderful example for all of us today. Instead of focusing on the temptations, instead of focusing on the heartache, we need to remember it is written. It is written that you and I are children of God. It is written that you and I are forgiven children of God. It is you and I that are reminded that we are people who, as we sang a few moments ago, are living stones built into the body of his temple. My friends, that's how we live our lives. Focusing on the truth, not focusing on the temptation, but keeping our eyes on Jesus. And finally, as the Apostle Paul says, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. Yes, my friends, God doesn't want us to be divided in our minds and hearts. God wants us, on the basis of his truth, on the basis of his wisdom and understanding, to be people individually and collectively, be of one faith and one heart and one spirit. And that's what we need to continue praying for, that God continues to bless us and uphold us during these dark times. While there may be very much more darkness that we may have to endure in the weeks, months, maybe years ahead, we're not alone. Is with us. Christ is with us. Christ is for you. He will never leave you or forsake you. So may we then take to heart these words of the Apostle Paul and be alert, be perseverant, understanding our enemy, but also, above all, understanding the power of God. Amen. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us rise for prayer. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, we ask you to be near us with your word and spirit. Guide and lead us that we may not stray from the way of your commandments, nor forget the wonderful blessings that you have given to us. Direct us always with your word of truth. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
By your Holy Spirit, protect us this day from the assaults of the devil. Equip us with the full armor of God, that we may be clothed in truth, righteousness, peace, faith, and salvation, bearing the sword of the Spirit, which is your word. Keep us all in safety and security from the forces of the evil one. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, preserve us from all that would defile us in heart and soul. Keep us from all evil thoughts, immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, and foolishness. Create in us a pure heart of God. Renew a right spirit within us, that we would be holy as you are holy. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of all knowledge and wisdom, grant us to know you and your love. Bless masters and teachers, parents and grandparents, and all who teach the faith, that the gospel may continue to spread throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, you are the strength of the weak and the refuge of the powerless. Be with your people who are struggling with doubt and temptation. Grant assurance to the doubtful and deliverance to those tempted by the world. Give your power, your grace, and your love to those who need it. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord of life, bring health and healing to your people. We pray for everyone in need of your mercy today. Strengthen them with your word of grace, that they would look to you for comfort in the midst of suffering and pain. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, purify our hearts with your cleansing word. Remove all impurities from us and enable us to lead godly lives before you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
For our closing prayer this morning, we also need to pray for the needs of our country, and especially for those families in our country who are experiencing the loss following the deadly attack in Afghanistan. Let us pray. O Lord God, you see that of ourselves we have no strength, but by your mighty power, defend us from all adversity that may happen to the body and from all evil thoughts that may hurt and assault our souls. O dear Lord, we commend to your care those families whose hearts are broken with the loss of their sons as a result of a deadly attack in Afghanistan. We ask you to draw near to them. By your grace and almighty power, direct them to your words and promises that you are the way, the truth, and the life. And as you did not spare your own son, but delivered him up for us all, that he might bear our sons on the cross, grant that all of our hearts may be so fixed with steadfast faith in our Savior, that we may not fear the power of any adversary, and commend ourselves, body and soul, to your gracious care, as we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen.
Our Our service concludes with our final song, Peace Be Is Yours. Please be seated.